Hey, what's up, Grio fam? We are live from our studio in New York City with your daily dose of the Grio Live. How are you today?
I'm great. I'm glad you're back.
Didn't we
miss Natasha on Friday?
I missed all of you so much on Friday. I was in North Carolina visiting my best friend, handling some business.
That sounds fun.
Yeah, but I see Todd Johnson, our managing editor, held it down.
It was a bros Grio Live.
He
did a good job. He wasn't Natasha, but he was good.
Well, so happy to be back with you.
Yes.
And happy to see you all out there in the internet world. So go ahead and hit us up in the comments. Let us know where you are streaming from. We'll shout you out throughout the show.
Yes.
We love to see your thoughts and comments. And
always.
So I heard that on Friday you guys threw up a picture for Caption This.
Yes.
And got some funny responses.
It was none other than Remy Ma.
Okay.
One of the hottest rappers right now in the game.
Yes, dressed for a funeral.
She wore this outfit at Wendy Williams.
Yeah, I did see that interview.
And she said that she was dressed for a funeral.
Yeah, I saw. You know what so what did people say about this photo first? What were the, were there any jokes or?
Primarily that, you know, she killed Nicki's career. Mm-hmm. And we're still waiting for Nicki's response. We're probably not going to get it, so.
Yeah. Well, you know, people have debated whether or not, I mean, the thing is, if you kind of don't say anything about the drama, then there's nothing to, there's no more drama stirred up,
true,
right?
True.
So someone is in Nicki's ear.
She might be taking a page from her friend Beyonce.
Yeah. All right. So the next photo of the day, we're going to throw up on the screen and we want you to comment.
Yes.
You will have until the end of the show today to send us your comments. So this is our Caption This photo of the day.
I love this picture.
The lovely and talented Viola Davis will tell you why she is so excited a little bit later in the show.
Uh-huh.
But go ahead and take a look at that photo, and then we'll come back at the end and ask you how to caption this photo.
Yes. I can't wait to hear your responses.
Okay, great. So we're going to get into some news. I see some folks are hanging out in our comment stream. That's a good thing. Were you paying attention to the news this weekend, and did you hear the drama about Obama and Trump and wiretapping?
Mm.
That's going to be our first story of the day.
Big news, right?
Very big news. We already got some comments in here. I love, love, love when people tune in. Hey, Kathy from Brooklyn, what's up?
Hey.
I've been thinking about moving to Brooklyn, actually.
I'm from Brooklyn.
I live in Harlem now. I'm thinking about Brooklyn.
Me too.
So shout out to Brooklyn.
You trying to leave us in Harlem?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Shawnee is checking in from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Shout out to you. Linda Clark is checking in from Houston. Hey, Houston, what's
yes,
up?
Yes, we love it.
I hope it's warmer down there than it is here.
Oh, yeah, it's freezing here.
Peony is checking in from Florida. Kia is checking in from Philly, city of brotherly love. I love that place, man. Philadelphia is great. And hi, Lynette from New Orleans. I remember you from our show the other day.
Yes.
Thanks for coming back.
Awesome.
All right, well, if you all are ready, then we are ready to go. We're going to talk about the top news story of the day, starting with Donald Trump versus President Obama and the case of wiretapping.
Wow.
So Chuck Schumer, Senate Minority Leader, had a little bit something to say about the fact that Donald Trump feels the need to point fingers at former President Obama. It's still President Obama.
Yes.
Okay, so this whole wiretapping accusation, people feel like there's no evidence for it, but nevertheless, Donald Trump insists that this is what's going on. So Chuck Schumer was on TV talking about this case, and this is what he had to say. All right. It might be coming. It's on the way.
It's coming.
Well, look, President Obama has flatly denied that he has done this. And either way, Chuck, the president's in trouble.
All right. There we go. We got it on screen for you. So he feels that the fact that the president is sort of reacting this way, bringing up President Obama's name, shows that he has something to be worried about. Maybe there's something bigger coming down the pipeline.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about it? And then what do you guys think about what Chuck Schumer said? You go first.
Well, if he had evidence that President Obama and his administration somehow wiretapped him, I think that he would have taken a different route. The fact that he took to Twitter to say something about it and then his administration said that they would look into it shows that he never had evidence to begin with.
Mm.
So the question is, you know, clearly there's a smoking gun here. He's responding because he's scared of more information being leaked. Since the day he's been inaugurated, even before he's been inaugurated, there's been leaks about his campaign and now his administration's contact with Russia. And I think that there's more to the story and that it's getting really hot in the Oval Office, mm-hmm. and this is why he responded the way he did. But it's a very serious accusation to insinuate that a sitting president did this, because that means he would have had a court approval, mm-hmm. and there's literally no evidence whatsoever that this ever happened. And we also know that the only evidence of this being reported was from Breitbart News, a right-wing conservative site. We know that Stephen Bannon, his chief strategist, was head of that site.
Yeah.
And so all these are connected, and it's all a conspiracy theory, and it's not fact.
And some people are saying that this is actually meant to be a distraction from the investigation into Russia.
Right.
So every time, you know, there's this sort of media drama, some crazy tweets come out, then the media has to run around and chase and verify and fact check that story. And it's a distraction from the bigger story, which is it seems that there seems to be something with this Russia case.
I think he's scared. His attorney general had to recuse himself from the investigation, which means if an independent prosecutor comes in there who's not going to, you know, be Trump's yes man, that means they'll get to the truth. And he's scared of us getting to the truth. And the question is, why is he scared?
Interesting question for us all to think about. We're going to look to you in the comments to see what you all have to say about this. Husamuddin, welcome back. We remember you last time. You were commenting in the comments. Husamuddin says, my forever President Obama will not lower his standards to even comment on this madness. From Harlem.
Well, okay. He did. Him and his administration have denied, obviously, this ever happened. There's also a policy that the White House administration would not get involved in independent investigations. And when President Obama was in office, this was an independent investigation. So they are denying all the allegations. And so we'll see how it moves forward.
Okay. Well, Linda Clark Nwoki says he never had evidence, and we know everything President Obama did was watched. So that's a really good point. The president himself is under surveillance, has so much security. How would this be something that he could actually get away with? And Virtuous brings up the point, why is Donald even the president? We haven't seen his taxes yet. Well, there are a lot of folks that agree with you there.
Yes. Congresswoman Maxine Waters is still on the prowl for those taxes.
She wants those taxes. She's also been talking about impeachment a lot.
A lot.
Well, it's interesting. We'll see what happens over the weekend. Mm-hmm. FBI Director James Comey asked the Justice Department to reject the idea that President Obama had anything to do with this wiretapping.
Another big move.
Yeah. But Comey was also kind of brought into the drama with the whole Hillary Clinton email investigation.
And allegedly, Hillary's team blamed him for her loss.
For her loss. So now he's stepping up and sort of defending the president.
Guilt, maybe?
Maybe. Could it be? We don't know. This always seems like an episode out of House of Cards.
It really feels like it. I can't believe this is actually our government. This is like the status right now.
Yeah. This comment comes from Shanice. She says, I don't think he was just lashing out because he had a lot of interactions with the Russians. Maybe the Russians did it. Who knows?
Maybe they're turning on him. I hear that they're not so happy with him after all. So they were once supporting him, and now it's not so, you know, clear, crystal clear.
Well, something tells me we don't have to wait long to find out. There's going to be another news bombshell, and we will keep watching that.
Yeah, stay tuned.
Along the lines of the presidential election and the outcomes and results from that, a story came out of the Washington Post talking about the fact that gun sales have dropped since President Trump was elected. But for minority groups and LGBT groups, looks like smaller clubs are seeing an interest in people who want to buy guns. Mm. Now, this is really interesting.
It really is.
What are your thoughts on this? And the story was very interesting from the Washington Post. They spoke with the president of the National African American Gun Association.
Who knew that there was one, right?
I didn't know there was
one either.
But now we should definitely look into what they've been up to. He said that they went from about 700 members to 7,000 members since Election Day.
Wow.
So people are feeling like, you know, according to this president, Philip Smith, that they could be attacked for their race or their identity in some way in this new Trump's America. Mm. And so they want to be able to defend themselves should they get into some sort of altercation. So they're going to gun ranges, they're buying guns, and they're learning how to shoot. Mm. People are not here for the BS. Like, they're really feeling both fear, but they're also feeling like they need to fight back.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I'm not surprised. I mean, look at the dozens, the countless videos that we've seen of people being called the N-word, of swastikas being, you know, being put on people's cars and homes. Like, people are being targeted more than we've seen in quite some time, and it's because of this divisive presidential election. Mm-hmm. And so I'm not surprised that everyone has the right to bear arms. I think it's more so interesting that we typically, when we think of black people or people of color and guns, you know, the media, or especially the right wings, they like to, like, project us as criminals, and we're not often the face of the pro-gun movement. And so, and the NRA has been really silent about this as well. They should, right. They should be happy about this, right?
Right.
But they're not speaking out in droves like they normally would when there are other discussions about gun rights.
You know, this reminds me of the history of the Black Panthers and how when Black Panthers started mm-hmm. carrying guns yeah. and saying you should be armed and yeah. doing so in public spaces, mm-hmm. people wanted to shut that down.
Right. It was fear.
It was, yeah. Right. It was like, no. But right. what about the Second Amendment?
Right. What about our...
Everybody's right to bear arms.
Right.
Well, Cleveland Bernard Small says, good, welcome to the revolution. Yes. And I encourage you all to check out the story. We've linked to it on our site, but there are pictures of African-American yeah. Gun range members who are learning how to shoot. They're checking out firearms. Yeah. But overall, gun sales have dropped, and gun manufacturers are now, they're stuck with all of this product, which they're going to, you know, the story alluded to maybe selling things at a discount or trying to get rid of all the guns that they have. Mm. So I don't know. I mean, do you think that there should be more guns on the street? That's a question that we can throw out to the Grio fam about whether people should be, you know, it's okay to arm yourself as a private citizen, or should we be trying to get more guns off the street? I mean, it seems like it's almost competing interests here.
You know, personally, I never got the pro-gun movement. I do believe that we should be able to protect ourselves. Mm-hmm. But the level of vitriol that surrounds this debate always surprises me. Mm-hmm. So I'm not really sure, but I certainly believe that there should be less guns on the streets. I think okay. that most people who have guns don't need them, yeah. and especially illegal guns. I mean, that's the first and foremost we should be tackling. Mm-hmm. But in terms of legally owning a gun, as long as you are cleared, by the way, President Trump rolled back regulations on gun ownership. So now if you have like a mental mental history, you can still get a gun. And when we see these mass shootings in schools and movie theaters and churches, you know, we should be wanting to not loosen laws, but, you know, regulate gun control. We're not saying you can't own a gun, but it should be like smart policy around it.
Yeah.
So this is, you know, it's always going to be an ongoing debate. I just wish it wasn't, because I think yeah. it's common sense.
And I don't think we haven't reached that place yet where, excuse me, where common sense background checks and all of that exists. You know, like you said, there's these loopholes where people can still, yeah. People who shouldn't really have a weapon have access to it, yeah. and then it, you know, creates situations that end up being really tragic or right. contributes to that.
Right.
So we'll continue to follow and see what happens with gun ownership, especially in the African-American community. It's yeah. such an interesting story.
Right. But if you have a gun, you know, keep it safe from your children.
Yeah.
Have it locked up. Know how to use one.
Yeah.
And make sure it's legal.
Yeah. This comment comes from Maress Williams Jr. Maress says, no, it's the white to bear arms. Little play on words
like
there.
That.
So just the difference between how minorities are treated when they have a gun yeah. versus people who are not yeah. of color.
Strong point.
All right. Well, I think we might have one more story related to politics today. I know it's a lot.
It's a lot. It's always so much going on in Washington.
Shout out to Cordell, who's in the comments. I see you. Thanks
Cordell.
So much for stopping in to check in. So, okay, let's talk a little bit about this GOP congressman who compared poor folks without insurance to something that maybe Jesus would have wanted. It's a very interesting story.
Yeah.
What did you think when you read this story? You want to break it down for the Grio fam?
Well, Representative Roger Marshall is a freshman congressman from Kansas.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that he's not on board for Obamacare's Medicaid expansion because he is sure that some poor people simply don't want health care. He is a doctor, by the way. And he said, quote, just like Jesus said, the poor will always be with us. And he said, there is a group of people that just don't want health care and aren't going to take care of themselves.
So why should we expand Medicaid? There's some people who are always going to be poor.
Right, that just let the poor be poor and let the sick just, what, die?
It's complicated. It was part of a larger article where he was talking about healthcare and expanding Medicaid and access. And he was saying that some people essentially wait until the very last minute to get help. So, you know, they wait for some extreme situation like pneumonia or having their, you know, a limb chopped off to go to the emergency room. And that's the only time they want to go to the doctor. But the story was saying that studies have shown expanding Medicaid actually reduced visits to the emergency room. Mm. And it actually ended up being a good thing for people to have that available. So it's just, you know, I always, whenever people try to like play on Jesus's words, politicians, and they try to bring religion into it, it just gets messy. And sometimes you just want to be like,
wrong move.
Jesus' name out your mouth.
Wrong move. I mean, you know, the Republicans, they hate Medicaid and Medicare. They've been for years wanting to roll it back, to dismantle it. So his rhetoric is not surprising, but it's dangerous because to suggest that poor people want to be this way, it's just not true. And how about we focus on, you know, literacy and making sure people are going to the doctor? Why don't you partner with non-profit organizations and do outreach to make sure that people are utilizing the services that are available to them? Don't just look at data and say, well, this is how it is, so just accept it. That's not what government's for. You're supposed to be a leader, so lead the people to better health. But he's not, you know, he doesn't see it that way, obviously.
And we know that health is tied to everything, you know, just being able to get a job or keep a job or, you know, just there's all of these things are connected, health, education, poverty. And so the idea that we're just going to kind of leave people where they are and just accept that some people will always be poor, I think we have to fight against that. The same thing with veteran homelessness. There have been some cities that have completely eliminated homelessness, you know, so to... I think it's better to be solution oriented whenever we're talking about these things. And if you're interested in checking out the study, it's actually from the Harvard School of Public Health. And they did a study about expanding Medicaid in Kentucky and Arkansas. And they said that people who had received expanded Medicaid under the Affordable Care Act, they had fewer emergency department visits. They had more preventative care and reported higher quality care. Mm. So the debate over Obamacare is going to continue, obviously, but it's so important to have the facts whenever you're talking about what's going on. This comment comes from Glenn Bruce. Glenn says, unfortunately, public office is refuge for the incompetent. So just because somebody is a politician doesn't mean they always know what they're talking about.
So true.
Yeah, yeah. All right. This actually, we have a comment going back to our previous story about gun ownership increasing for in some areas for increasing interest from minorities in some areas who want to own guns. This comment comes from Husamuddin, who said, I heard today that they will be allowing guns on some college campuses. Mm. So expanding, again, access to guns. Yolanda Jones says, not African-American, but people of color that are not U.S. citizens. They're already picking up on African-Americans in New York, and they're not picking up on other races. So I don't know, Yolanda, if you were talking about the gun ownership piece, but that is something to watch. Now, Kay Denise is commenting on her story about healthcare. She says, this is just ignorance. Everyone deserves good quality healthcare and affordable care and not for profit. All right.
Amen.
Thank you so much for your comments.
Thank you, guys.
Well, we've got some entertainment news that
let's change the pace. Politics is so depressing sometimes.
There's a lot going on. Let's talk a little bit about entertainment news and the big drama over Tyrese sharing that he got married to a black queen. We're going to throw up the photo that's causing all this debate on Twitter, or caused a bunch of debate on Twitter, about Tyrese and his new marriage. Mm. Apparently, he got married on Valentine's Day. Posted shortly after about his new wife and how excited he was, and he put hashtag my black queen.
Seems innocent, right?
Seems innocent enough. You're married, you're happy, things are going well. But apparently some folks took a look at the photo of Tyrese's new wife, and they didn't understand how she could be considered a black queen, because maybe to them she doesn't look black. So Tyrese eventually had to clap back after there was some clarification that his wife does, in fact, have mixed race heritage. Oh, these were some of the reactions.
Tyrese said
he found his black queen, but his wife looked everything but black. question emoji.
Okay.
All right. So that's just one example of the way folks were feeling about.
They were mad.
They were mad. I mean... Tyrese had all these videos about marriage this, black woman that. Then he comes out with this woman. Please, I don't care. That was from Katie. All right. Tyrese's wife is Jamaican, Ecuadorian, and African American. That's three different types of black. How y'all gonna say she's not black? I'm confused. Bloop. So people came with receipts, right? And in fact, just because I don't know why they assumed by looking at her that she couldn't be black, but his wife, Samantha Lee, is Ecuadorian and African-American and Jamaican. Awesome. So she's a mix.
Multicultural.
I think we all know black folks come in all shades and colors.
Yes.
But I guess the controversy is because he put my black queen, people didn't understand how she was supposed to be black or why he put it in the comments. Mm-hmm. So the question to you all is, are people making much ado about nothing? Like,
good question.
What was the big deal?
What do you guys think? I really want to know what people think about this, because this story went over my head. I didn't see why this became such a big deal. He's not the first celebrity to marry or date a woman who is of lighter hue, who happens to be black. I think that maybe seeing the word black queen, people automatically expect to see a woman who looks like she is like from Africa, like Afro, darker skin. Maybe that's what they think of when they think black queen. But again, if we come in different shades and colors, and why, I don't understand the controversy.
And I think the fact that he even put hashtag my black queen, I think he was almost trying to stop the criticism before it started,
right? Because he probably
knew
that it would come.
Right, because if he didn't put my black queen and people just looked at the photo, they might assume, oh, she's Spanish, oh, she's Indian, or whatever, and then start to criticize him.
Because to be fair, I wouldn't immediately say this is a black woman, but I wouldn't immediately assume that she's not either.
Right. Well, you know, this always hits close to home for me, because people have always guessed and could not figure out sometimes what I am, or have assumed, made certain assumptions about me. My mother is Puerto Rican, and my father is African American. And when I was growing up, they taught me, they say, you are both, always. Like, you're not one more than the other, and you're a person more than anything, but you embrace both sides of your heritage. But depending on how I would wear my hair, maybe it's curly, or maybe it's straight, or maybe I'll do a weave or whatever, some people would guess one thing or another. But at the end of the day, that's a part of my heritage. Yeah. So you can't say that I'm one thing or I'm not, just based upon my looks.
Yeah.
And I think, especially in this country where we have a history of people of different races mixing, going all the way back from slavery, where there was rape and intermixing, you know, unwilling. Bloodlines have always been mixed. We have always been sort of related in that way. So there's no such thing as a, you know, pure black or more black than the other. Like, in this country, there was the one drop rule. If you had one drop of African American ancestry in order to keep racism alive, you were black.
Yeah.
And so I don't know. I think that they should applaud the fact that she embraces her heritage.
Yeah, it's really an issue it's a global issue. I mean, we are so divisive. It's like, well, I'm this and you're that. I mean, even if you go to Africa, some Africans wouldn't consider us African because they say we're Europeans because we're from America, and so there's always an opposition to your identity, your prescribed identity.
There's always these debates,
even
within the black community, right? You know, African Americans versus people who came from the islands, or people who actually came from countries within Africa. It all depends. But anyway, so we have some great comments going in our feed.
Let's hear them.
Gotta acknowledge this one comes from Danielle. She says, only miserable people are affected by his love life. Our beautiful blackness comes in an array of colors, from the whitest of white to the blackest of black. Love is love.
Yeah.
Shout out to you, Dave.
Not to mention, I feel like we all have someone in our family that looks like her.
Yeah.
And so to reject her as a black woman is a rejection of our own.
History.
We should never do that.
There are African Americans who actually passed back in the day who were so fair-skinned that they could have been perceived as white. Some chose to pass and some chose to live as African Americans, but you can't always judge a book by its cover. Amy Daniels says labels are so limiting, and I definitely agree with that. Glenn Bruce says, look at me. I'm black, enough said, and my children are by a quote-unquote black queen. Shout out to you, Glenn Bruce. I love it, love it, love it. So anyways, we wish Tyrese the best.
Yes, congratulations.
And his wife, who also happens to have a master's degree.
Awesome.
And, you know, reportedly makes six figures and is doing her own thing. Yeah. So just as important as how she looks is the fact that she's a good person.
Right. And that's why all that matters.
That's why he says she's his queen. All right. So our final story for the day actually has to do with another black queen that we love.
And this one's not going to be controversial.
It's not. Jerry, you want to tell us why Viola Davis was at Harvard?
Well, you know, like our girl Rihanna, she was honored by Harvard for Artist of the Year. Yeah. And I think, who else but Viola Davis to win Artist of the Year? She won an Oscar recently, a Golden Globe. Mm-hmm. You know, we know her from How to Get Away with Murder, but also from Fences. She's just an all-around amazing performer, and she really deserved it.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I can't think of a better person to win this award than Viola Davis. Yeah. Artist of the Year is a huge, huge honor. And this is the second time Harvard has honored a black woman just this month. Yeah. Rihanna was just there the other week, winning an award for her humanitarian efforts. So we absolutely love Viola Davis. Love that she's getting her due, finally.
I know.
This woman has been working so hard in the industry for so many years. Yeah. She did the small roles. You know, she's played maids before. She's played drugged out mothers.
She played an attorney like a million times on like those shows like CSI and...
Absolutely. And now she's on How to Get Away with Murder and all that. So congratulations, Viola. We are so happy for you. So we're going to end the show today by bringing you back to that photo of Viola Davis and her husband. All right. There they are.
She looks so happy. She's got the Oscars.
And we want to know, how would you caption this photo? Any thoughts?
I would say, oh my God, I just won. She can't believe it.
She's like, oh my God, it never gets old. It never gets old. Every time she wins, she's like so excited, no matter what.
You know what I think of when I see this picture? I think of Beyonce's song with Jay-Z and DJ Khaled shining. Because like she had the gold, it's like, you know, the gold statue. She's glowing. It's just a representation of just shining.
Van E. Crawford says, free mimosas at PS 450.
I used to go there for brunch a lot, actually.
Actually, that is my face whenever I have an opportunity to drink mimosas. Kimberly Natasha said, oh, hey, Kimberly Natasha.
Hey.
Same name. Shout out to you. They love me. They really love me. And that's true.
We do.
Amy Daniels says, winning.
Oh, Michael Clark says, take that, Meryl Streep.
Yes, she is just like glowing from the inside out. Glenn Bruce says, hey, Mom, I did it. And that actually does sound like something Viola
Davis
would say.
That's a great one.
Because she's really proud of her heritage. She came from, you know, poverty and worked her way all the way up to be one of Hollywood's best actresses.
Wow.
So thank you so much for all of your captionless comments. We really love them. And Carol Johnson says, just overall about Viola, she's an outstanding actress, a trailblazer for women of color in the industry, especially with that speech that she gave about, you know, opportunity and making a difference. I think we all should be very proud, no matter what our background, but especially for the fact that she has spoken about opportunity for all.
Because we all deserve it.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you guys for spending your lunch break with us. We love, love, love to see you guys in the comments. And we hope that you share the stories that you see on The Grio. Go to thegrio.com, hit the share button on Facebook so more people can read and talk about the issues that matter. And I want to give comment of the day.
Who's going
to
be?
To Danielle Crooks. Danielle wrote, only miserable people are affected by someone else's love life. Our beautiful blackness comes in an array of colors, from the whitest of white to the blackest of black. Love is love.
Amen.
I think that's a great way to start our Monday.
Yes.
Definitely.
Wherever you go, take love and joy with you.
Take love and joy. Yeah. All right. Have a great one, Gerren.
You too.
You all have a great day. We'll see you on the next session of The Grio Live.
Yes.